Le dioxyde de carbone, ou CO2, est le second gaz à effet de serre naturel et le premier gaz à effet de serre anthropogénique. Avant la révolution industrielle, les échanges de CO2 se faisaient entre la biosphère continentale et l'atmosphère d'une part, sur les flèches vertes sur ce diagramme, avec la photosynthèse qui prend du CO2 dans l'atmosphère et rejette du dioxygène, la respiration de la végétation et des sols, et les feux qui, à contrario, vont prendre de l'oxygène dans l'atmosphère et rejeter du CO2 dans un échange à peu près équilibré.
The exchange was balanced.
Deuxième type d'échange,
second type of exchange,
grandeur,
same order of magnitude, exchanges between the atmosphere and the ocean surface.
Avec, dans les zones des eaux chaudes, area, un dégazage de CO2
being released into the atmosphere around the equator,
et dans les zones d'eau plus froide, de moyenne et haute latitude, plutôt une absorption de CO2 par la surface de l'océan. Une fois dans l'eau, le CO2, contrairement à l'atmosphère, où c'est un gaz inerte, contrairement
to the atmosphere,
c'est un acide faible,
et donc il va se dissoudre
sous forme d'ions carbonate et bicarbonate, et avoir donc tout un cycle chimique qui se met en place, et
contributing to water becoming more acid.
On a aussi
absorption
by phytoplankton,
marine vegetation of CO2, which is then released
in the enfin, les flèches noires sur ce diagramme représentent les autres flux qui permettent de boucler finalement le cycle du CO2 pré-industriel avec le volcanisme, l'érosion des roches qui a plutôt absorbé effectivement du CO2 de l'atmosphère, le transfert de CO2 de carbone généralement depuis les surfaces continentales vers les rivières, vers l'océan, et la réémission de l'atmosphère. Ce qu'il faut noter simplement, c'est qu'au niveau du cycle industriel, on a un équilibre
pre-industrial cycle was a balanced
CO2, en fait,
cycle where CO2 was exchanged between various reservoirs,
continental
land, atmosphere and oceans.
The pre-industrial
activity was shown by a primary productivity in both oceans and continental ground.
Provided by satellites, which provides a primary representation,
it's not an exact quantification, but we see more or less where we can find a primary production. There is a vegetation index seen by satellites, green and blue areas in the equatorial forests, and North America, and also Europe and Asia for average latitude. Maximum productivity on continental land, 60 petagrams of carbon per year of exchange approximately, and the exchange is done by vascular plants.
Et la limitation de ces échanges, en fait, c'est la lumière, la température, l'eau et les nutriments,
water,
le carbone,
nutrients, so carbon,
sur les océans.
In the ocean,
on a, grâce à la chlorophylle,
which is shown here
by the satellite,
we have an indication of primary productivity in northern Atlantic, high productivity, Australasian, and along the coast, especially where we have the large rivers, and primary productivity is substantial and shown by the satellite image.
On estime, il y a des modèles à 50 pétagrammes de carbone par an, c'est le phytoplancton,
phytoplanktons
guaranteeing
productivity,
and
the limitations are not water, but rather light nutrients. And iron.
Cette, ce cycle naturel équilibré est perturbé depuis la révolution industrielle, peut-être un peu avant, mais fortement par les émissions des combustibles fossiles liés à leur combustion, donc
fossil fuel combustion, first oil, then gas, pour un total d'à peu près
7,8 × 10⁻⁶
pétagrammes de carbone par an pour les années 2000.
Autre source de CO2, c'est le changement d'utilisation des sols, le fait de déforester, de brûler, de convertir des terres entre des forêts, des prairies, des cultures et des urbaines, a perturbé le cycle du carbone et a contribué à émettre de l'ordre de 1,1 plus ou moins 0,8 pétagrammes de carbone par an, c'est un peu plus faible, mais aussi plus incertain relativement.
It's a lower flow, but it's still important.
Now, the map of emissions for fossil fuel combustion is shown here.
Three main areas, unsurprisingly, North America, Europe and Asia. But in Asia, we see a shift of emissions from Japan to China during the last 15 years. Here we see a few emerging countries such as India, Brazil and a few African countries which are now playing a role in CO2 emissions.
Regarding the evolution ever since the 60s, here we have the type of fuel being burned, oil until the year 2000, coal, which has lost speed but is now picking up speed again and is really fueling the Chinese growth or the Asian growth,
and is the main source of CO2 due to Asian combustion, and we must compare Asia with the rest of the world, because through these
émissions, on fabrique
emissions. China is also manufacturing products which are then being used by other countries in Europe, North America, Australia, and therefore part of the CO2 emissions, which should maybe be attributed to those countries that use the products being manufactured in China. Some colleagues are working to make calculations and reassign some of the CO2 emission to industrialized countries. But definitely, coal is the biggest growth, and there are still huge reserves of coal available. Now we have CO2 emissions per country or per capita, in red per country, in gray per capita. Per country, we see that China is leading the pack ever since 2007 in terms of CO2 emission for fossil fuel combustion, followed by India and the USA and Russia. But if we divide this per capita, we see that all of a sudden, outside of the Emirates, the United States are leading the pack now with the highest emission. The average American citizen releases twice as much CO2 as a European citizen. And this shows that in Europe, some measures were taken after the petrol crisis in the 70s in order to improve the way energy was used, which decreased the CO2 emissions, and this does not hold true in the United States. And we also see that in China, because China is a highly populated country, therefore the CO2 release per capita is much lower. A Chinese citizen releases as much CO2 as an average European citizen, although there is a huge difference between rural areas and urban areas. So these two aspects must be taken into consideration, because if we could negotiate per country in international negotiation, we should also take into consideration the fact that each citizen has the right to a certain quantity of CO2 released in the atmosphere so that he can develop with his family and relatives. Another source of emissions due to human activity, deforestation. In the year 2000, the two countries which contribute to deforestation, Brazil and Indonesia, the other countries play a much minor role, but still 40%, especially in African countries where deforestation has happened and where reforestation is now happening in order to try and mitigate the consequences of deforestation. If we were to add up the two types of disturbance, fossil fuel combustion and land use, we see that we start from 2.15 petagrams to a much almost 10 today. And until the 90s, we were at an increase of 1% per year. But all of a sudden, because of the recent Asian growth, the CO2 emission increase is now closer to 2% per year rather than 1%. And this is a steady increase. For land use changes, we started from 1.4 petagrams of carbon per year, and we're now reaching 0.9, so a decrease. There seems efforts regarding reforestation are bearing their fruits. We have a peak in 97 due to the change in land use. The peak is due to El Nino, a natural event which led to a drought in some areas of the world and forest fires, whereby more CO2 was released into the atmosphere. But again, this is not always only due to anthropic intervention. It will be interesting to see what emissions will become once they reach the atmosphere.